Hello, this is Rev Brad, and you're listening to the Soccer Chaplains United podcast from the Touchline. Well, it's the month of June. There's lots of football, lots of soccer going on right now. International breaks, we've got the Euros going on, preparations for the Summer Olympics, and more. Today, I have special guests on the pod with me, Jubal McDaniel. Jubal is the volunteer chaplain with the Tacoma Defiance of MLS Next Pro. He's been part of Soccer Chaplains United since 2020, and he's been a great addition to the team. Earlier this year, we announced Jubal as our Pacific Coast Chaplain Manager. He's been helping us with various expansion and growing teams and cultivating chaplains and supporting chaplains that we have. So we'll talk a little bit about that. Unfortunately, Jubal is an Everton supporter as well as a Seattle Sounders fan, but we're going to look past some of that. And with all the soccer events going on, part of our conversations this month, we wanted to look at some of the devotional books we've written for major events, namely the World Cups. Jubal's played a big part in a couple of those projects. And also what's special with Jubal and special about today is he's going to be our first guest to play a second round of crosses with Rev. He gets a chance to move up the leaderboard. We're going to let him quiz me with his own questions too. So I've broken our conversation into two parts. And just after this, we get started with part one.
He's found the space and he's found the back of the net.
Just a little off foot, thinking he's going to go far post. Not strong enough with his right hand.
Whips that one in. Far post, almost made him ends, and they have. He has the hat-trick. The second in his career. The third of the night. The hat-trick hero.
Talked about you're not going to be able to sustain that kind of pressure.
To the corner. Goes towards the near post. And you're the angle, and what a goal! What a goal!
Jubal, welcome to the podcast today. Excited to have you.
Yeah, excited to be back. Let's do it.
Bro, you've been on the podcast before. It's like you're a seasoned pro. And, you know, last time we were talking a preview of MLS Next Pro. Tell us, how's Tacoma Defiance doing so far, you know, this far into the season?
Yeah, it's been a little unexpected, I would say. Even some of the commentators and some of the games have talked about, you know, some of the higher expectations of Tacoma coming into this season after having two really successful seasons and the inaugural. But all in all, you know, the team continues to battle through, getting some really tough results. They're digging deep and continuing to push through as a unit, right? We don't see a lot of the splintering sometimes that can happen when a team isn't doing well, but they're really kind of gelling and working together. We've also seen some of the challenges early on in this season, right? In being affiliated with an MLS club that itself is struggling with injuries and dealing with fixture congestion, right? It's the inevitable next man up. And so we've seen a lot of our kind of more veteran players being called up to first team duty, which is always fantastic. But ultimately that leaves the Defiance a little bit stretched. And what has happened is we've seen some of the younger academy kids that are new that we haven't been able to see before that are getting their first professional exposure and being challenged at that next level, which has also been cool.
Yeah.
So maybe while the results haven't been super positive, we are seeing some really cool things happening at the different levels.
Yeah, Kevin and I were talking about, I mean, Rapids 2 is struggling kind of bottom of the table. But we've got a really brand new group this year. The first team's doing really well. They've called up, brought up some of the Rapids 2 guys from last year who are now, you know, they're starting to fill out the 18 on game day. They're more in the mix for first team training. So it's almost like it's hard because I think it's like the MLS Next Pro is doing what it's supposed to do. It's supposed to develop the player and get them ready to make that next step. But then it's really hard. You know, Kevin and I were talking, it's like Rapids 2, they were doing so well last year, almost won the championship. And it's like, but that's not what it's about. It's about the first team and the development. And so it's hard to keep that perspective. And I think last year for Rapids fans, Rapids 2 kind of became the silver lining because they were doing well when the team wasn't doing well, the first team. And so, yeah, it can be a really, really bit of a mix. And Man, I mean, kudos to you and Kevin and Jonathan for managing the emotions that go with that, because it can be really difficult year after year, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Especially when you see some of the roster turnover too, which can be difficult. You know, you get to a locker room and a set level of experience and brotherhood that can be built, especially around a successful season. And then to have so many different changes in the off season can be difficult, because they have to regel and build that chemistry. And then, you know, even week after week, the roster itself can look different, and guys are having to play out of position sometimes to fill a need and fill a hole. And so they've got to just continually be flexible and try to make the most of every opportunity that they're given. And again, continue to support that first team. And that has been one of the other successes that we've seen, is that our guys have helped the Sounders to advance in the Open Cup, which has been a huge rallying cry, especially with some of the other first team challenges that we've seen with their results this season. So there's a lot of energy around that specific competition, and just using that as a platform of hope.
Sweet. Nice. I love it. Love it. Jubal, one thing that's new too with you, as compared to other years, other times you've been on the pod, is your role with Soccer Chaplains United. You have a new role that kind of began January of this year, although technically you were kind of doing some of this in advance, but you're the Pacific Coast Chaplain Manager. Now that's a mouthful, but really, for those that don't know, that role really is about developing out other teams, other chaplains, other opportunities, and then supporting the chaplains that are within that time zone. So how's it been going? I mean, you don't have to say I'm a great boss or anything, or that you love working with me, but what's it been like for you to kind of be in this role? And here we are, you know, here we are in June. So six months into it, are you loving it? Are you liking it? Are you ready to be done with your contract?
Yeah, who's going to buy that one out? I definitely think that my market value has increased, if I can say that. But it's been a little bit different than expected, but I would say that in a good way, right? For this is a brand new role for our organization, and a little bit of a kind of a pilot, if we can say that, where we're trying to be flexible in this new role to say, this is where we see a need. This is where we see our organization growing, and that the Lord has blessed our work. We don't know exactly what it's going to look like or the time commitment, but this is, again, a need that we have. And so we kind of had some ideas coming in early of what that would look like. And some of that has come to fruition, and some of it has looked a little bit different than what we thought. And so I've been much busier than expected, but all that to say that I really enjoy this work that I get to do. It has given me a different perspective of chaplaincy, of our organization. I love getting to interact and learn, and also build up and encourage some of our other chaplains, and just engage with them in a new way, rather than just making handoffs or sending my team to them. Right now, we get to kind of have a little bit more of a camaraderie, a little bit more of a deeper relationship. And I've really found that to be quite valuable.
Yeah. Well, I've found it to be valuable. I look forward to sort of our Monday. We usually have some sort of call or meeting, catch up on Mondays. I mean, to be honest, I've been doing this for so many years now, 23 seasons as the Rapids volunteer, but really doing this role since 2015. And it just feels, it can feel lonely, you know, to kind of lead a nonprofit like this. And you're supporting a lot of people. You've got relationships and friendships, but to have someone like yourself that's working a little bit more invested into it, and as you said, your transfer market value just shot up through the roof. So, you know, we're expecting any day one of the big clubs across the pond to come calling and say, we want to tap Jubal McDaniel. What's the transfer fee? But
Bro, it's been great to have you working alongside and with and helping grow chaplaincy. I don't know how you feel, but I love, you know, one thing that would happen to me early was people would come and be like, hey, have you heard the Broncos don't have a chaplain? Do you want to be the chaplain? Or the Avs or the Nuggets? Hey, have you ever thought about doing chaplaincy in another sport? And I mean, ever since we rebranded as Soccer Chaplains United, I just love being able to go, nope. Hey, my thing is soccer. The people that I've been around the longest that I'm still trying to learn and know is soccer people. And chaplaincy is my gig, my vibe. It's the thing that I do. So like, I can almost say like no to a lot of things because I've feel like it's been kind of laser focused. How does that feel though for you, Jubal? Like, have you felt like, I don't know, do people come to you? I mean, you've just come from working in an athletic kind of role with a school, so lots of sports that you've been involved in and leading a lot of ways. I mean, there could be chaplaincy applications across many different things, but have you ever felt tempted to, like, with other sport or other things, to get into some of that?
No, I think for me personally, I really haven't. I don't necessarily follow those other sports as much as I do with soccer. I mean, to be honest, I really don't. And for me, it's so much easier to see a lot of the kind of scriptural gospel kingdom principle cross with soccer. And maybe that's because I've lived in that world for, you know, the last decade plus. But for me, there really hasn't been kind of that temptation or that draw to shift into other sports. I think some of that too is just the different cultural nuances of those sports and the people that follow them, right? It's very different than soccer, and that it just doesn't really fit as well with me, like my personality and who I am and kind of what I'm looking for and what I enjoy most. So I can't really say that that's been a draw for me.
Yeah. You know, you said something that I think transitions just right into my next question, the next part of the conversation that I want to have with you. And that is, you've worked on a couple projects with us, specifically the 2022 Men's World Cup Devotional and the 2023 Women's World Cup Devotional. And, you know, what I've loved about these projects, writing is one of the things that, I mean, I don't know that I'm the most gifted writer or a gifted writer, but I enjoy writing. And I enjoy translating. I enjoy, maybe we might say, paraphrasing, amplifying, whatever it is, scripture and soccer, or the biblical story, the biblical narratives into sort of things that we see in soccer as well. And so you've helped on a couple of those projects. You've helped specifically with interior graphics on the books. And you know, we've been working on this revision to the five women you meet in faith and football. But tell us a little bit, you know, I've got just kind of right in front of me right now the world, the 2022 World Cup devotional that we did, The Light Is Coming. What was it like working on these projects just generally? Like, you know, I think I just kind of came to the whole team and said, hey, can anyone help? And you're like, hey, I can do graphics. But what was it like for you to kind of work on the 2022 World Cup, the men's devotional that we did?
Yeah, it was a little interesting. I think coming at it from the very beginning, I kind of had different thoughts in terms of what the kind of graphic contribution would look like, meaning that I may have been kind of the primary contributor. Which I think overall worked out that wasn't the case. Not to say that, you know, I had different thoughts or ideas, but just the fact of, like, we got to involve other people in this project that weren't myself, and that we kind of went with this idea or this theme of, like, hand-drawn art. Right? Like art that looked different than just computer generated. And those were some of the conversations that you and I had early on too, about potentially having some of these generated by AI and some of these other things. And it just didn't really fit and mesh well with the other art that we had received and that others had contributed, and it just didn't sit well. And so one of the things that I really enjoyed most about this project was we had kind of this theme of writing that had you guys had kind of put together. And then from my perspective, I was able to kind of sit back and say, okay, well, here's the art that's been submitted that kind of fits this. And then here's the writing. And then we kind of found this story of how these two things meshed together, where we had this character, this football character, that really kind of told this story of how he found the light and then eventually became transformed by it and then was able to then share that with others along the way. And then not only his story, but kind of the larger global story. And that's what we find in the cover, right? The little dots of light in those kind of characters that all are, maybe they know each other, but they're all kind of dispersed throughout the stadium, right? And kind of dispersed in different aspects of life. And so that was one of the things that I enjoyed most, was kind of just using the art to kind of tell that story, that step-by-step and process of how he kind of goes through his life as a footballer and also the how he engages with this light.
You know, as you say that, I want to give some context for those that might pick up a copy of the World Cup devotional or our revision, The Light is Coming. What's interesting is we didn't have conversations between the art team and the writing team. And as you say, you're so kind and gracious, Jubal, hand done art, you know, or how did you phrase it? Just like,
yeah, hand drawn.
This writing, the art team was actually my daughter led it up. At the time she was, I think 16, 17 years old. And, I asked her, hey, could you do some art? And, I had some different visions of how this would go. And, they had some different ideas that I think we had to work with, but it really came together well. And it just affirms my belief in the sovereignty of God, because, I don't think we could have directed. I couldn't have directed it. I didn't direct it. But it kind of came together. And as you said, I love the way that the art told a story that paralleled the writing and complemented it. And, you know, there were a few pieces that needed some touch up or some places where I think some of the artwork that we received, this idea of light, and you'll see it at first, it kind of grows in the soccer ball and then transfers to the athlete. And then the athlete hands it off to another athlete. That idea, we kind of had to tweak a little bit, but what I appreciate, Jubal, is that you helped tell the story. And, you know, there's some things that I learned. Just, this was our first publication, our first writing, and we just felt like we need to do something. This World Cup is special. It's happening in Qatar. It's happening through November, December, which is not usual. Usually it happens through June, July, right? And this is going to be a unique time. The season of Advent and Christmas is going on throughout this World Cup cycle. And just, can this be part of the message? Can this be part of the messaging? And then just to see the way that you took on the art. And, you know, folks, just to let you know, Jubal helped craft the interior art and the covers. We had to do different covers because we had a version in Spanish and Portuguese as well. So we adapted some of the covers as well. And this was an exciting first project to work on. I think we learned a lot from it as well. So man, just appreciate your work. So shifting a little bit, we then went on, we go, hey, we did this devotional for the Men's World Cup. We need to do one for the women as well. And they were following on the year after. And so we thought, we've got the energy, we've got the team to do this. And the writing team actually didn't work out. I had thought we're going to have a whole stable of female chaplains that can write. That didn't work. But, you know, talking about the five women you meet in faith and football a little bit, this was a little bit different. So Jubal, maybe talk about the art as we worked with the women's devotional.
Yeah, and if I recall, we kind of had a tighter timeline on this one, the second go around. But as you kind of said earlier, we, having worked with the men's devotional, we kind of had a way of working now, like a way of understanding. So I felt like we had a little bit more experience and understanding on, you know, like how this thing works. We had a template to work with. We understood kind of the software and the things that we were working in, demands of publishing, that made some of it a little bit easier for us to kind of have that platform to launch from. But yeah, coming into the artwork, again, a very similar process of having, you know, kind of some hand-drawn art, a little bit of that watercolor feel, which I felt like added, you know, a little bit of like the beauty to it, right? The uniqueness, the different flavor, whereas the men's devotional had a little bit more, kind of the grayscale art, but that specific yellow and orange, right, centered around that light for a specific reason. But now we had a little bit more color, a little bit more kind of a playful, eclectic feel to it, which I really kind of prefer personally. And then we kind of kept some of that torn look between the two, right, to create kind of that similarity between the different books that we were kind of producing. And then we're able to really kind of highlight some of these women. And the thing that I enjoyed most, or at least one of the things, was creating each of these characters as a footballer, right? Like putting the modern day woman in their shoes, or if Rahab or Ruth, right, were a footballer, what might they look like, and describing them as a character, and putting, you know, tying those two worlds together, right? The very distant, like ancient Israel with modern day world football, right? How do you do those two things? And so trying to tie those things together through art, I thought was really, really powerful.
Nice. Well, we're going to take a short break, and there's a revised devotional that's coming out. We're going to hear a little commercial about it and be back right after this.
Hello, I'm Rev Brad, director of Soccer Chaplains United and the author of the devotional book, Five Women You Meet in Faith and Football. I wanted to let you know we've just published a second edition of the devotional book. Following on from the 2023 Women's World Cup, we've refreshed some of the artwork and revised the book to make it a bit more timeless. This devotional features 25 readings introducing you to five very special women in the Bible. Looking at their unique personality and character strengths, we see themes that one might also see on the soccer pitch amongst our athletic heroes of the beautiful game. Imagine setting these biblical ladies into your starting lineup or first team squad. Tamar is a commanding center back. Maybe Rahab playing as a crafty number 10. Certainly Bathsheba could be an informed striker playing the 9. Five Women You Meet in Faith and Football, check it out. It's available on Amazon either in paperback or Kindle format. The devotional is designed to be read individually or to be used as a small group or team study. Five Women You Meet in Faith and Football. Read and reflect more on these women who, in the strength of God, went beyond greatness.
Okay, so Jubal, in relation to the five women you meet in Faith and Football, I'm curious, do you have a favorite art piece personally? Is there one that just grabs you?
Ooh.
You're on the hook. And this is not crosses with Rev, so no.
Yeah. You know, I really enjoy a lot of them. I think early on, one of my favorites was probably Mary. I think, you know, kind of that zoomed out donkey scene with the jersey draped across was pretty, pretty sweet. But I think all in all, my favorite, I probably have to stick with Rahab. I think it's very simple, right? Where it's not very people centric. So it's just kind of that rope and then the red jersey, right? Signaling, you know, the clothing that she kind of hung out the window. It's rather simple, but I think just the powerful imagery there, really, really captures me. And I'm somewhat biased too. Like that's probably one of my favorite stories, in the five, even though, right, it should be Mary because she's the mother of Christ. But for me, like, that was probably the one that I felt the most drawn to or enjoyed the most, even though it's probably the most simple.
Yeah, I agree. Between the two, especially in the original book, Rahab and Mary were my top two favorites for sure. But I think that Rahab, the incorporation, so just to give a little bit of feedback, is as we were talking with the art team, which was a different art team for this book, we had a board member, Kaylin Phelps, who really led up the art. She did three of the pieces that are in the original book. And then in the revised work, we had her do all the art. But she led up the art team. And as they were talking, they said, what thing can we use to tie in? Is it a, you know, a lot of athletes personalize their boots, their cleats. But we really got, you know, that could be kind of individualistic. Let's have a jersey. Let's have a jersey in each of the pictures that's kind of incorporates the women's story. And I think Rahab's image does that best because, again, as you mentioned, the scarlet cord that she ties in the window to signal, there it is as the red jersey. And that just, I mean, for me, it just ties in the story with the art, with the idea. What if Rahab was an athlete, was one of these women out on the pitch? And that's just exciting for me. Jubal, let me ask this. On the men's World Cup side, was there a picture that, I don't know, spoke to you most or was most fun to work with or to have to see? Well, friends, right there, we are going to pause the podcast, pause the conversation. We'll come back next week. Tune in as Jubal and I play Crosses with Rev. And you're just going to have to come back and see who wins out. I can't give it away, although I know what has already happened, and I'm not too happy about it. Anyway, we look forward to seeing you next week. This is Rev Brad coming to you from the Touchline.